It's now my real pleasure, and I really genuinely say this, I've had the pleasure of being connected to Altawa Station Hall for many years, and today he comes to you as the president and CEO of Mackenzie Health. He came to Mackenzie Health in 2010, and in a very short order, brought that hospital to receive the highest rating in Canadian healthcare with its accreditation. I've been through a couple of those in the hospital system. This is not an easy feat. It involves engaging the entire hospital, all the staff services, working together, and that is no easy task indeed. He is also, before coming to Mackenzie Hospital, has been Senior Vice President and Chief Operations Officer at Mount Sinai. And prior to that, he was site executive at Brampton Civic Hospital and also at William Osler Health Centre. He is also an adjunct professor at the University of Toronto, the Department of Health. What many of you may not know is that he is at the Olympic level. Now, he didn't go to the Olympics because of good reasons, God help me, but for wrestling. So he is he does not shy away from the ability to land the important efforts. And ladies and gentlemen, he is landing the City of Vaughan and the hospital. Please come and share with us the latest and greatest.
Updates as to what's going on at Mackenzie Health, and in particular, obviously, the excitement of Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. A great amount of effort on behalf of our board and our staff, and just to give you a perspective before I get into the slide deck, our staff, a couple of hundred, are involved in the specing of this project. So they work a normal shift, our physicians, our nurses, our support staff, and then they come to user group meetings in the evening here in the morning. So this is a real effort, running the hospital and building a new one. And all of our staff live and breathe in this community. So they're very passionate about the role and the opportunity for growth as it relates to healthcare services. So I'm going to give you a little bit about the environment and sort of where healthcare is going. Funding is key, so we talk about capital projects, but at the end of the day, they have to be funded in operating dollars, and those dollars are key to ensure that we can provide access and appropriate services and deal with the waitlist that we know we have in the system in certain places. Planning for growth, that talks about the Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital in particular, but we're going at it a little bit differently. It's not just about the building, it's how we deliver care in that building, which is key. Obviously, we're here to understand some of the business opportunities. We are one of the largest employers in the North region, and we will become that much bigger as we ramp up from Mackenzie Vaughan. So clearly, there's a relationship with business locally, but there's also significant employment opportunities as the hospital opens in the next number of years. And just a little bit about our priorities and achievements. I'm going to talk about our innovation agenda as well, and then Tiziana Rivera, who is our Chief Nursing Executive and Chief of Professional Practice, will talk about some of the amazing things that are going on at Mackenzie Health in terms of innovation and how we're advancing healthcare with technology and improving quality and safety in our environment. So this slide talks about some of the key influencers, and you may or may not know that there's dramatic change in how hospitals are being funded, and this is a good thing. So in the past, we were funded with an envelope of funding. Now we're going to rate-based funding and payment-based on activity. So I'll get into that in a little bit, but some of the key metrics that are tied to this are outcomes. So as a taxpayer, as an individual consumer, it's a great thing that we are actually incented as a provider now to be focused on both quality and unit price so that you're getting value for money. And I'll get into the detail of that a little bit. Transparency in the system has gone to another level. With the ECFA and other legislation, boards are much more focused around the quality agenda, which is a great thing. 10 years ago, you probably didn't hear too much discussion at a board table around the outcomes and the quality services that are being provided at the hospital. This is now center and core, and the executives in the hospital are now being held accountable. So, as an example, I have my pay at risk every year based on some of these quality metrics, and if they're not met, obviously my salary is deducted. The these are good things and obviously improve the outcome of care that we provide. So we'll talk a little bit about that transparency on what that is from the public perspective. We have an update going on. Obviously, the action plan for health and the movement of primary care and the integration of primary care is key. So you may have heard about an initiative called Health Links. It's trying to bring a disparate number of providers together to ensure that we can actually link services better. We do a number of these engagement sessions a year, and what we tend to hear more often than not is, yes, I want a new hospital, yes, I want better access, yes, I want shorter wait times. But the biggest issue is the coordination of care. The system is not really a system. So Health Links is an initiative, and we have actually just been approved for Southwest York Region as the lead for Health Links. It's intended to coordinate care much more effectively. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And obviously our strong financial position. In 2010, Mackenzie Health had some financial challenges. I'll tell you about our remarkable turnaround and how that puts us on a solid base to grow services, especially as we look at the Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. So Health Service Funding Reform, or HSFR, and you'll see lots of acronyms because just like any industry, we like to look smarter by using acronyms. This is an acronym that talks about a dramatic change in how hospitals and providers in healthcare are funded. So what does it mean? Obviously, I won't get into the technical details of it, but in the past, hospitals were funded with an envelope of money. So I was given a base budget of $100 million, and that was my budget for either 10 cases or 100 cases. And what started to happen was the downtown hospitals that have larger budgets, larger bases, and that increases odds, a percentage of that base continued to grow. The hospitals in the periphery, the GG95, didn't grow as fast. So what tended to happen was access was better in the 416 than it was in the 905. So when you came to a GTA hospital, the waits were long. The waits were long because the funding wasn't necessarily there. So what this new funding formula is intended to do is those 40 to 50% of residents who leave Southwest York Region to access care because they can't get access from a waitlist perspective, will start to be able to shift their care upwards. So what this funding formula finally does is it puts money where people live. And that's been our biggest challenge. So you may come to Mackenzie Richmond Hill Hospital, and if you come to our merge, it's a zoo. It is so busy. We are growing by 5,000 to 6,000 visits a year. We opened that merge department in 2009. It was built for 80,000 visits. This year we'll do 93,000. So we're over capacity already. So we know that there's been growth in the GTA 95. Funding hasn't necessarily moved to where people live. This funding formula will make those adjustments. So it's a great thing for the residents who live in the GTA 905, and in particular, in Vaughan and Richmond Hill, where we have the largest amount of growth, we'll actually see dollars shift. This has also been the biggest challenge of advocating for our new hospital. So we can talk about the capital dollars that are needed for a hospital. But until you're able to move the operating dollars, it's very difficult to justify a hospital. So the argument is made one of the largest cities in Canada without a hospital. And that's true. But the fact is that those residents get care in other hospitals. And those other hospitals have the operating dollars in their base budget. So those dollars are going to start to shift, and you're going to get care closer home. So it obviously justifies the second hospital for Mackenzie Health. But it also means that as time goes on and more money starts to move out of the 416, we'll be looking at future expansions at both hospitals. Even though we voted in 2019 and opened the door, there'll be further pressure for growth and for expansion. So I think that's very, very important from a context perspective, especially from the business lens that you have, and as you look at the growth of healthcare, it's going to grow much more rapidly in the GTA 905 regions, and in particular in Southwest York region. This sort of shows you our financial turnaround in the context of this new funding formula, but also in the context of what we've done as an organization, which is to really embrace lean methodology and reduce waste. And we've done that by empowering our frontline staff to give us the information saying, well, you know, if you did this a little bit differently, you could actually do it faster, you could do it more efficiently, and you could do it with a better outcome. So we do at least 10 events a month where we engage frontline staff to tell us how to do things better. It's lean and Kaizen methodology. Those of you that are in manufacturing, we've been doing it for decades. Healthcare is a little slow, but we've adopted it. So if you look at this financial turnaround, we were forecasting almost a $10 million deficit in 2010. We've now done 4 years of continuous surpluses. We now have about $25 to $30 million in the bank, no debt, no deficit, and the ability to grow services with our own balance sheet. We've improved our position to the point where we grow our capital budget from $5 million to $9 million. So the basic tools that you need for the trade, we're able to reinvest ourselves based on our financial management. So again, as residents of this community, need to know that we are managing healthcare dollars and tax dollars as diligently as we can, and that's the evidence of it. So planning for growth, no surprise, you know that we're in the midst of Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. We've been supported with $58 million as a planning grant, so that's how we actually build the specs. And I know there's lots of statements around, well, you know, we've been waiting. A hospital is not a small project. We're talking about 1.2 to 1.3 million square feet. I know there's a lot of bidders in the room as well. You know the technical requirements to spec a hospital takes years. The ability to understand the service delivery model and the types of services takes years to design and to work through with government. So this is no small feat, and then you've got to build the thing. So this process didn't start till 2009. This was at the very beginning of the ministry process to put a business case forward for Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. And since 2009, we've moved at a rapid pace, and I'll get you into that timeline. So right now, our staff are in this phase called PSUS, Project Specific Output Specs. So these are the technical requirements, the bid documents for the hospital. And there are volumes and volumes of information that have to be created to go to market. The PDC, so that's the planning and design consultant, that's Zyber. They're working with our users and our frontline staff to help build those specs. We have a bond council that's hand in hand working with us. They have approved the precinct plan, which starts to block the lands for this development. We're going forward with 40 acres for the initial build and 10 acres of additional expansion space as we grow over the near future. Infrastructure Ontario, they are the procurement agency of government, so they build all types of infrastructure, from hospitals to courthouses to transit to the service centers that you see along the 401. So they are the arm of government that ensures that other components of government that deal with specific projects have a consistent way of delivering infrastructure on time, on budget, times a week to continue to advance this project, and they are basically working hand in hand with us to take it to market and then provide the oversight during construction. Our RFQ, so this is the request for qualification, this is how the bidders, the consortia qualify. That was issued in March, the bids have come in, and our staff and I are busily evaluating those submissions. And those consortia then will go forward to the RFP phase, which will be sometime in early fall. So again, you may hear that it's not happening. I can tell you we're pretty busy. If you're telling me it's not happening, then I don't know what I'm doing every day and my staff are doing. Obviously, this doesn't happen without a lot of community support, and we're fortunate, I know Chairman Fish is here. The region has stepped up for not just Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital, but for all the hospitals in the York region to contribute infrastructure dollars. And I have to tell you that without those dollars, our ability to convince health and the province to commit to a project is very difficult to achieve. So that local share that has to be generated from the community is vital, and the region plays a key role in that. So again, we're very fortunate. We're unique compared to other jurisdictions who don't have that advantage. That's the leadership of the region in contributing not just to ourselves, but to Martin Stowell and to South Lake and their respective capital projects. We also need land, so land has to be a pre-requirement for any project to proceed. We were fortunate that the city had the wisdom to acquire land just north of Wonderland, and those lands are where the hospital will be built, so they're a key part. And the foundation. So we are in the early stages of a capital campaign. This will be one of the largest capital campaigns in your region to help fund the local share for this project. So again, your involvement and your support in that would be key. And it's a requirement for every single project, whether it's Oakville or Humber. These are sort of the principles of how projects get done. The community support is vital from a support. support perspective, but also the financial commitment. Now, we do a lot of this as an organization. It's my duty and the board's to engage our community. We hold sessions every November in Richmond Hill and Vaughan, their larger town hall sessions. But we also go to ratepayer groups, to religious groups. We're out at least two or three times a week giving these types of presentations because, again, as business leaders and the community, we need to know what's going on. So we will continue to do that. And if you're interested in having us speak to your group, just go on our website and there's a form that you can fill out. And obviously, we will be happy to come out and speak to you. So a little bit about Mackenzie Health. You may not know that beyond the Richmond Hill Hospital, we have many other locations. So obviously, the biggest and most exciting component is the soon-to-be Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital on the right-hand side. But we have a number of community-based locations in Vaughan and Richmond Hill. And they will not disappear as we open Mackenzie Vaughan, because this is where our clients like to actually receive care. So on the top left, you see a Vaughan location. This is where we provide cardiac rehab, as well as our diabetes education. We have some corporate offices there, the foundation and finance. On the bottom Vaughan, you see our chronic kidney disease center, where we provide outpatient dialysis and a number of other services for mental health. In Richmond Hill, you can see locations that we provide outpatient rehab, another location for outpatient dialysis services. And up in Barry, we actually provide acquired brain injury services and other mental health services. So these are important locations because they obviously provide services closer to where people need them. And you don't need to come to a hospital for everything. And that's sort of how we see our space in terms of service delivery. This is the distribution of services between the two hospitals. So what's key, and what we heard from the community, is we want full service hospitals. We want an emergency department, both in Richmond Hill and in Vaughan. And that is key. So the Blue H will be on both hospitals, as well as a number of other key services like intensive care beds, medical surgical beds, all the things that support care, such as medical imaging, laboratory, surgical, inpatient and outpatient. So these are all core components to both hospitals. We then have to decide, how do we distribute regional programs? And we could have taken the approach of having duplicate services, but the sites are 8.5 kilometers apart. But more importantly, the ability to sub-specialize can only occur when you have a certain critical mass of service in one location. And that's how we can actually attract the best physicians and clinical staff. So let me give you two examples. In Richmond Hill, we will be hosting our seniors in our chronic disease program. Now, what is a key component of that is geriatricians. They're hard to find, and you need to give them a reasonable amount of activity and volume and location to attract them. So we will have a center of excellence for seniors and chronic disease at that location. Same can be said for birthing. So birthing will be in one location in Vaughan. Again, consolidating those volumes in one location enables us to have more subspecialty services. But we can now have an obstetrician specialized in medical conditions so that a mother who has diabetes or other medical conditions can actually deliver in a hospital with that subspecialty care, as opposed to what this center or Mount Sinai. So this is how the medical manpower component really drives care delivery. So it's not just about, well, we want to put a shingle up everywhere. It's about having sustainable programs that are delivered at the highest quality. And this is how we distribute some of the other services. Doesn't mean that if you come to one of the other sites, we can't connect you to those other services. But this is the more sustainable model for these types of regional programs. Now, key metrics for the hospital, and again, we are in the final stages of speccing this, but you can see some of the metrics around beds and emergency visits and pediatric visits. What's more important is this is sort of the everyday picture we have built and have support from government for significant shell space. We know that as soon as we open it, it'll be too small. So we don't want to have to go back and put another submission for a capital project. So we are building multiple floors of shell space. We are building what's called soft space between. So administration is considered soft space because maybe we're kind of soft somewhere, I don't know. But it's space that can be decanted somewhere else so that clinical services can grow. And this is a massive facility. It will be over 1.2 million square feet. So the scale and scope of this is just immense. It's immense. Now, obviously, with this project will come a number of construction jobs. And we know, and we will support local trades, that's the nature of how we tender these projects. And we see, again, when we look at comparable-sized projects, when we look at Oakville, when we look at Humber, at least 1,000 construction jobs will be created. And that will support the local economy and continue this region to thrive. As well, we would see a number of healthcare jobs created. So this is sort of full-time equivalence. They'll actually be more positioned than this because the nature of healthcare is that we're a 24/7 business, so we have a lot of part-time and casual staff to ensure that we can get 24/7 operation. But you can get a sense of the order of magnitude: almost 2,000 staff, 100 new physicians, and 700 volunteers. So we have a huge growth agenda in front of us, and obviously the benefit, and what I'm amazed at, around this community is people like to live and work in this community. So most of our staff actually live in the region, and they take pride in their hospital, and obviously they're very excited about what's happening with the addition of Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. So what are some of the benefits? Obviously, we see an operating budget that's today $275 million that will only continue to grow as we grow additional services. We are engaged with over 550 businesses at Mackenzie Health. Now, we are obviously governed by a pretty stringent procurement guidelines, broader public sector procurement guidelines, and I hear lots of challenges for some of our local businesses to obviously transact in that way, but we are accountable to the public, and obviously we have very, I would suggest, very robust procurement guidelines that we have to follow. About 150 of those businesses are from your region, and they range from linen providers to electrical contractors to med-surg suppliers, a whole host of providers across the region. One of the most amazing things about your region is it's actually the largest cluster of health-related technology providers. So it is kind of the Waterloo of this region, and Mackenzie Health, as well as the other hospitals, are finding better ways to transact with these local innovators. And you'll hear some of that in Suzanne's presentation as well. So we're open for establishing relationships. We have obviously ways in which we will transact with you, but we want to support the local economy, and obviously we encourage you to get involved with us. So this is a diagram that kind of depicts the actual transaction phase of this project. And giving you an example of where Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital is in relation to two visible projects that you can see, one off Highway 47, one off Highway 401, and that's Oakville and Humber. So they are obviously in the midst of construction. We are in the transaction phase, and we are closing off the RFQ in the next month or so, and the RFQ will go in the fall. So we will be in implementation once we award the contract through that RFQ phase. So it's happening. It'll take about 3 years to build, a little bit longer. It's a big facility, but things are happening. We're also working with the city to get some early work started because we do need to prepare the site for some of the infrastructure that has to be in place for project work to come on board and build it. So you will be seeing activity this summer on that site. Now, we use this diagram to reframe the project. A building is just a building. And obviously it will have the latest and greatest technology. But what we do in that building is even more important than a shiny new building. And in my role as an accreditation surveyor, I see organizations across this country. And there are some amazing organizations that do remarkable things in lodging space. So space is important, but the attitude and the culture of the organization are just as important. So we are continuing to evolve the service delivery model with our staff to understand the basic elements of what makes the patient experience satisfactory or ultimately exceptional. And most of that actually comes down to communication and engagement of families and patients in the care that they're receiving. We need to continue to keep an eye on our finances. So as much as we have a good balance sheet now, it's very easy to lose sight of that, especially when you're in a growth mode. Those of you that run private businesses know that actually the most challenging times when you're growing your business and doing it in the right kind of sequence and doing it responsibly is key. So we know that yes, we're healthy now, but as we grow and double in size, we have to keep an eye on our finances and our efficiencies. It's easy to get a little sloppy in terms of your bottom line. Growth in facilities, I think I've spoken about that. Technology. So Healthcare has changed. If you built a hospital 20 years ago, 10% of your overall project budget would be your technology. Because it's so technology intensive now, we're almost seeing a rise of 30 to 40%. So it's not just the building's a shell. The amount of technology and hard equipment that goes into the building is massive. And it's gotta be coordinated, it's gotta work, and the staff have to be able to use it the day they come in. Our first patient has to be treated as safely as our 10,000 patients. So there's a lot of work to be done with all of these new tools and technology to get your staff to that right place. The culture of the people is a huge challenge. As you know, as business people, it's hard to shift culture. It takes decades. What I can tell you is staff at Mackenzie Health are amazing. They are truly committed to providing the best care. But a lot of stuff gets in the way of that. And some of that stuff is what administration they put in front of them. Some of that stuff is some of the requirements that are defined by legislation. But we know through our lean exercises that there's ways to reduce the waste to enable our staff to spend more time with patients. And you'll hear some of that from Tiziana as you look at some of the innovations. Our goal is to have our frontline staff engaging with our patients and not hunting around for supplies or spending more amount of time documenting. There's ways where we can reduce efficiency so that our staff are engaging, because it is a service business, it is a business of interaction with patients and families. And community perception. So this is all about that. This is about conveying information and ensuring that you're engaged as to what's going on. So as much as we're excited about the project, these other, we call it the teething ring. We're teething on it right now. But those are the other dimensions that are just as important as that green box that you see there, which is growth and facilities. It's just a sense of the other scale of projects that are currently done. So you can see Halton and Humber, we're in that ballpark in terms of the project scope. So these are large, complex transactions. I'll give you a sense of how it works. So there are four major players that come together to deliver this project. There's the designer. So as much as we have Zeiler, who's putting the specs together, the architect of record will actually be project host architect. So they will take, in effect, what is called output specifications that are narrative. They will take that and translate that into design. And we'll have three competing designs going through this process. So with the consortium is also a builder. So the builder and the designer work hand in hand. And I know that they have challenges because sometimes they have different priorities, but they have to put forward a building that's competitive from a bid perspective, but also meeting our requirements. Financier, so this is a financing deal where the building's paid over a number of years, so there's dollars that are brought to the table, and then we pay for this project over a 30-year contract period. And then there's a maintainer, which is to ensure that the building I get on day one is of the same value and the same performance on day 30. So what would happen in healthcare in particular is we would lose the discipline of keeping our buildings intact, because we would always be moving money around and say, you know what, I don't want to make that cut to the frontline service. I want to actually defer that roof being fixed, which made sense in the near term, but in the long term actually cost more money. There's a lot more discipline now on maintaining the building through these contracts that actually saves money in the long term. So that's how this transaction comes together. This is just a snapshot, if you can read it, of the Halton business. This is actually on the IO website, of the kinds of players that come together to form this consortium. So there were three bid teams, hospital infrastructure partners, primary health, and community health consortium. And you can see the various players that come together. Humber, similar players actually, because their bids were actually occurring at the same time. So you can see similar consortia and similar names. These are bid-specific consortia that are formed. And obviously in our case, you'll see the usual suspects. I can't imagine our size and our scale, it'll be very much some of the same players that you see up there. So again, complex transaction, a lot of work to pick the right partner, and then a lot of work to get it done. This is the site. So the blue represents the hospital land. So just to orientate you, this is north of 109 on your left. You can see Highway 400. On your right is Jane Street. To the south is Major Mac. It's an 82-acre site that the city purchased, and we are working with the city through the precinct plan process and the subdivision process, and also in the midst of securing a ground lease for the lands for this hospital. 40 acres for the initial build, 10 additional acres for future growth. And that's sort of the process that we're working through. As you know, if you live in the area, traffic is probably one of the biggest challenges. So we've done a lot of work with the city to ensure access onto the site and off the site is managed effectively in terms of how we look at signalized intersections and how we bring people on and off the site and how we orientate them so that, you know, the visibility of the hospital, you know where you're going. Because again, it's a facility of this size, 1.2 million square feet, you've got to pick the right door to get in, right? Otherwise, you're kind of needing some roller days to get around the facility. So we're very excited by this scheme, and obviously the bidders are going to see this as they go forward in the transaction phase. This is not how it's going to look, but this is an illustration of what it could look like. So again, as I said to you, this is just an illustration of the massing. And we use this more to work with the city around the busy plan and local residents to ensure that the zoning bylaws were reflective and respectful of the residents around us. So you can see that the massing is to the south side of the site to stay away from the residential community. Parking structure on the left-hand side. I again stress to you that this is not the design. The design will occur as we select our final bidder, but this is just how it could look. On the very south side, we see a medical office building that's obviously key to attract 100 plus physicians that we need to be co-located on this hospital project. As we work with Zyler to start to understand the types of things that we want to put into the words of the PSOS. So one of the biggest challenges in a hospital is how you enter the facility. And obviously, in the past, the institutional look was sort of where we went. We clearly have not been meeting the needs of our clients by giving them that kind of feeling as they come to the hospital. So what does this do? This entrance, I think, achieves two key things. It enables the scale of the building to be brought to a reasonable level. Remember, when we're talking about a facility of this size, it's massive. You need to kind of bring down the scale so you don't feel like you're entering this enormous building. And there will be multiple entrances, so you have people go to your specific entrance, and you necessarily won't feel like you're entering a 1.2 million square feet facility. It also, hopefully, reduces your anxiety. As people come into healthcare, they're pretty stressed, and they need something, I think, to kind of relieve them a little bit as they're coming in, or at least not agitating any more than they already are. Concept of an operating room. What's different is the fact that there's access to daylight. So most operating rooms are in the inner core. This is a new concept that's been put forward and has been tried in many other jurisdictions, and it introduces natural light. Why? Because our staff are in that room for 8, 9, 10 hours a day. As well, a lot of our patients are now actually awake during the procedure, conscious sedation. So actually access to light is benefiting them as well. So these are again new concepts. You can see the technology around them, but it's a very different atmosphere than you typically see in some of the older hospitals. This is an emergency department. So one of the first things you should notice here is there's no curtains. So curtains are a nightmare from an infection control perspective. What you see here is glass, and these glasses have the ability to be screened when required. So it introduces a lot more open space and obviously a much better environment from an infection control perspective. So again, these are just early concepts that we're trying to use. Our staff find it very difficult to put their requirements in words, so you need some images to kind of get them to that place to understand how they translate those words into images, or images into words in this case. Concept of an ICU room. So if you've ever had to see an ICU room, you'll see a huge amount of equipment and technology around the patient. And it's a very daunting view when you come into a space like that. This removes a lot of that technology away from the patient bedside and introduces, obviously, views to natural daylight. So again, concepts that make an environment more friendly, more inviting, more holistic, more healing. Many studies have been done that demonstrate that access to natural light will improve patients' healing by 30 or 40%. Actual studies showing that length of stay is reduced when patients have access to natural light. So again, these are the concepts that we're trying to introduce into Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. Very quickly, I'm going to give you some of our highlights. So yesterday, we had a significant event at the hospital. We penned a memorandum of understanding with Sandbrook about 2 months ago. We actually announced that publicly yesterday.
We know that as we grow, our biggest challenge will continue to be access to tertiary and quaternary services. So growing one piece of the pie without ensuring that you have good access to other levels of care is not going to serve our residents well. So what we've done, we went out on a shopping trip, and we've talked to all of the big tertiary quaternary hospitals, and the board said, come back with a proposal of the best partner. And Sunnybrook came to the top. So what we're going to do is create a board of care where your access to tertiary and quaternary services will be streamlined and will be coordinated so that that handoff between our two institutions is seamless. We're in early stages, but we're working it through. So I'll give you an example of one that we've done just about a year ago. And this, obviously, this relationship formalizes it even more. Vascular surgery. So vascular surgery obviously has components of care that can be provided in our hospital. But there's a very specialized procedure called EVAR. It's a stent that's put in to a very small vessel. It's a very expensive procedure and it's very, very technical. We entered a relationship with Sunnybrook, Northrop General, and ourselves to do EVAR cases at Sunnybrook. So what happens now is our own surgeon, Dr. Futuri, will see you in the hospital, you'll come into a merge, we'll manage you there, and then he will transfer you and do your surgery at Sunnybrook, and then we'll bring you back. In the past, you would have had to go somewhere else, you wouldn't have been coordinated, it works much more effectively. The other thing that happens is one vascular surgeon isn't much of a department. So when Dr. Futuri sometimes likes to go on holidays, I don't have a vascular surgeon. Now with this integrated structure between Northrop General, Mackenzie Health, and Sunnybrook, we have 24/7 call for vascular surgery. Where Northrop General's vascular surgeon or Sunnybrook surgeon will come to Mackenzie Health and care for those patients. That's how healthcare is changing. You have to partner, and you partner not for the sake of the ivory tower of saying I'm going to do it all on my own, but you partner for the benefit of the patients so that you are getting seamless, coordinated care. And I think, you know, there was a view 10 years ago that I'm just going to build it all on my own and I don't need to actually play in the sandbox. Well, we do need to play in the sandbox for the benefit of patients. So we see more and more of these opportunities of coordinated care so that the residents of this region can receive better, more timely, and more coordinated care. And you can see some of the other examples that we're going to look at in the years to come. I have to talk about our achievements, that's the CEO's job. And now I can talk about them sort of from my view, but these are independent assessments of how we're doing. So I think Paula talked to you about Accreditation Canada. We achieved exemplary standing. Only a handful of hospitals have that in the country. And it was driven by a 99.6% compliance to over 2,000 standards. So we're very proud of that. It's a very significant achievement and it's obviously done independently. Nursing leadership, Tiziana Rivera was actually awarded a significant achievement at a provincial level for her nursing leadership. Accreditation for lab services, again, another important service. We do millions and millions of lab tests a year. Ensuring that they're compliant and that we have a high standard is key. And then a national safety award. This was linked to infusion pumps. So we have state-of-the-art technology for infusion pumps, which ensures that medical errors will not occur. Because the system is foolproof. It ensures that if an error is inputted, it's very easy to put the decimal in the wrong place when you're entering a number in the infusion pump of how much of a particular drug will be administered. This ensures that those errors can't happen because humans make errors and we have technology to make sure it doesn't happen. So we're very proud of these achievements. They reflect our journey, not just about growing services, but building high quality services. I'm going to speak to this very quickly. Tiziana's going to really get into the detail of this. We felt that as we grew our technology bundle with Mackenzie Vaughan and continued investing in Mackenzie Richmond Hill Hospital, there was going to be a huge opportunity to partner with industry. But industry partnerships were all about innovation and value add. So, you know, someone can sell you something, you may not need it, but they sell it to you anyway. This wasn't about that. This was us identifying the needs and the things that we wanted to fix and industry partnering with us. So we're doing it in a very robust way. We're doing it with academia as well. So we've actually partnered with Iowa Business School and they are actually validating a lot of our projects to ensure that the rigor of research and the rigor of science is behind everything we do. Tiziana will speak about four first-of-the-kind innovations in Canada that start to demonstrate where we're going. And our goal is to trial these Mackenzie Richmond Hill Hospital so that we grow the technology base at the existing hospital, but also move it into Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. We can't wait till we open the new hospital. We've got to deal with these opportunities today. And this just shows you schematically how we see that relationship. So we don't see ourselves being in the research space of a downtown hospital that looks at bench to bedside research around a new clinical treatment. We actually are looking at innovation when it comes to technology and how we can change care models. Because we will be investing hundreds of millions of dollars in technology and equipment. So why not understand the impact it could have? I guess the analogy I use all the time is we all have our BlackBerries. We use maybe 5% of the capacity of our BlackBerries because no one really trains us on how to use it. So we, you know, we use a couple of the features, but do we know where we can really drive our technology? So this is what this agenda is all about, is to leverage technology for the benefit of how we can improve. So with that, I think I'm going to get Tiziana to come up and then we'll answer questions.
I'd like to just
remind you, now I don't need to project. If you have a question, we won't be entertaining questions from the floor. We are asking you to complete the information in terms of a question, put it in the box at the back. And we'll collect those and we'll have the panel after Tiziana speaks to entertain those questions. So it is my pleasure to invite Tiziana to the Rivera to the podium. She is the Chief Nursing Executive and Chief Practice Officer at Mackenzie Health. That's quite a title. We're delighted to have you here, and her professional background is stellar. Not only as her strategic leadership offered at Mackenzie Health, she's also a published author. She has served a number of our Ontario healthcare institutions, including Trillium, Baycrest, and Mount Sinai Hospital, and those are all excellent facilities as well. So we're delighted that you're able to join us, your leadership at Toronto, University of Toronto, Ryerson, and York University. And now you're in this community serving us. I think, ladies and gentlemen, we're in very good hands. Please come to the podium, Tiziana.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here this morning. And yes, I do live in the community, and I consciously made a choice to come to work in my community and contribute to the development of a healthcare system that I can be proud of and that my family and friends can also take advantage of. So this morning, I'm really privileged to be here to speak to you about the innovation and partnerships at Mackenzie Health. I'll help set the context in terms of a very macro, very provincial vision for situating our organization. I really want to talk to you about what's happening inside the walls and looking at where partnerships may exist for us with you to get us to our next level. So the purpose of this presentation is to set the context for the innovation vision and areas of focus that we have strategically chosen, as well as identify where the key activities are for the innovation agenda, and profile our current innovation partnerships that will give you some clarity around what we're envisioning for certainly the Richmond Hill, but also the Vaughan Hospital. So I'm not sure if you can read that. I think just reflecting on Altaf's presentation, we were challenged with a number of strategic issues that positioned us to say we need to do things differently. And certainly our first and foremost was around the provision of care. And so we were doing a good job, we needed to do an exemplary job in providing safe, effective patient care. We knew that there were technologies and processes that exist out there. How do we invite them? How do we bring them into our organization to really elevate the practice and elevate the environment so that we can provide that care? We know that in healthcare there's a lag time in how we welcome those technologies in, and so how do we rapidly do that? in the most effective way. And we knew that if we did it, we would be able to increase our market share, certainly align with our new vision for the hospital, and do things in a very financially sound and effective way. We want to be able to differentiate ourselves as a hospital that's welcoming to innovation and looking at us as being able to apply it in an effective way. So when we look at our innovations and our goals, we basically had two starting off. We really want to look at developing a robust, sustainable infrastructure to facilitate the testing, evaluation, application, and diffusion of our innovations. So we are not looking at the cure for cancer. We are not doing the cellular level research that some of the downtown hospitals are engaged in. We really want to focus in on the applied technology, applied innovation, and looking at contributing to an evidence-based healthcare system design. With the opportunity that we have in Vaughan, we have that evolving, and we believe that with this specific, very targeted vision of applied innovation, that we'll be able to improve patient care, build a high-performing organization, and really become a leader in applied health innovation. So where do we thoughtfully and very intentionally put our focus? And we really want to look at evidence-based practices. We have about 14 regulated health disciplines within the hospital. And there's a lot of literature that sits on this shelf, and this is just the way healthcare is. It takes about 10 years before we get sound research applied into practice. That is way too long. And that is an industry standard. It takes about 10 years before it gets saturated into healthcare. So we want to look at how do we look at evidence-based practices and how do we rapidly implement them into our practice setting. As Altoff mentioned, we have an opportunity to really create a model of service delivery within Vaughan that supersedes anything else that we've seen in Canada. So how do we do that in a thoughtful and an innovative way, and using technology as an area of focus for us to move forward on? So our key strategies are looking at the processes of care within the service delivery model, so we can leverage technology and enhance the delivery of care. I think we keep talking about the shiny new thing, and sometimes as administrators and clinicians, we have vendors that come to us and say, you've got to have this doohickey because it'll do this, this, and this. And there really isn't an opportunity for us to look at it in a reflective way and say, how does this really meet our needs, and is this really what we want? And this is an opportunity for us to create that infrastructure, for us to look at and create that office where we can facilitate the testing and the evaluation. We know we can't do it alone. We need the partnership. And we want to partner with others to leverage the full value of products and services so that we can positively impact on the health service delivery model. So we want to look at this in a very holistic approach by looking at the people, processes, and technology. So this isn't all about, although, I'm a nurse by background, and certainly I want to look at the clinical practice piece, but this is about the people, processes, and technologies, and really focusing on the clinical, operational, and financial outcomes. We need to be able to look at it in a holistic way so that we don't spend all our money on one piece that impacts on clinical practice and then leaves us shortfall for other things. So we are really putting out a bold vision in terms of really asking our staff to come along with us on this journey to look at innovation in practice, patient safety, and evaluation. We want to look at these in their entity in and of themselves, and really elevate the innovation and the application of that into a practice environment. So when we look at innovation in practice, we have been very successful in the last 12 to 24 months in looking at innovation in practice from a really creative and innovative way. One of the projects that we have put in place is the automated post-discharge phone calls. And it is an innovation in practice. So we get a lot of feedback from our patients and families, predominantly through our paper surveys and certainly through our on-the-spot surveys, that talk to us about transitions in care. So when they come from the hospital and back into the community, sometimes it's challenging. We may miss components of it, even though we've got processes in place. So our Connect is a first in Canada partnership with NRC Picker, which is a national research corporation that administers our Picker surveys across the country. So now what we do is we have automated discharge calls going out to all patients who visit our hospital through eMERGE as well as discharged home. And so within 24 hours, you will receive an automated discharge phone call asking you key questions. And if there's a trigger, you will get a phone call back by the manager of the unit for follow-up. So that we want to make sure that your transition back into the community is a seamless one. We're the first organization in Canada to do it. We have been speaking about this widely, as well as the outcomes associated with it, and we're really proud that we've been able to make that partnership and have that as our testing for our patients in our community. Another first in terms of innovation in practice is our central equipment management. I know that this may be surprising to some of you in the room, but most hospitals do not have a coordinated, organized, centralized RFID process approach to managing their equipment. So it makes it very challenging for clinicians to be able to find the equipment they need to be able to provide the care. So our jobs as administrators is to remove every barrier to practice, every barrier to safe patient care. When we don't do that, when we don't focus on that, what happens is it's on the shoulders of the clinicians who touch patients. It results in delays of treatments, errors, and adverse events. So we have intentionally supported a central equipment management system that has a real-time locating device on our equipment and centralized that. And the benefits to that is that we all of our equipment is checked and measured to ensure that it's accurate and that it's in good working order, and we know where it is. I had a recent example where my father was in hospital and he needed a blood transfusion. He lives in Toronto. He was brought into a hospital. I had to wait an hour before the nurses found a pump in a Toronto hospital, and they were complaining off to the side that it's always so hard to find a pump, and he was delayed in his treatment for over an hour. Actually, it was 90 minutes because I timed it, and when the pump came, it was broken. It couldn't stand on the pump. The little hoopy at the back wouldn't work, and so that's a real example of what doesn't happen in our organization because of this first in Canada combination. Knowing where your equipment is, having somebody bring it to the clinicians, and it being in good working order. These are basic foundational things that are not happening in other organizations, and we are the first in Canada to do it. Hardwired patient safety and quality care through best practice guidelines. We are a best practice spotlight organization through the Registered Nurses Association of Ontario, supported through the Ministry of Health, and that we have intentionally integrated best practice guidelines in our electronic documentation system. And so we have a visual display of patients who are at risk for falls, who are at risk for pressure ulcers, all kinds of clinical conditions that are listed and integrated into our electronic documentation system. That is a first in Canada, and we worked really hard with our IT and our IS to make that happen. So the last innovation I want to speak to you about is our innovation unit. We're really excited about it. We turned on the switch on Monday. And it is, again, a first in Canada. We have had the opportunity to, through our capital equipment, to purchase new beds last year. We purchased 170 new beds, and that's a picture of one of them. And so it was the Cadillac. It was top-notch. They're called smart beds. Really sophisticated pieces of technology in a hospital that's about 50 years old. So we weren't able to turn on all of its features because it didn't have that integrated piece. It's like having a Ferrari riding it down in downtown Toronto. You can't really get the sense of it unless you get into the right environment. And so what we have done, and we connected with our partner and said, instead of doing a traditional transactional business partnership, I give you money, you give me beds, let's look at developing a different partnership. And the partnership really is about elevating this to a different level. So we have partnered with a vendor to transform one of our inpatient units. It's a 34 bed unit, and we have basically created a living lab. We have transformed that unit to include all of the technology with the goal of enhancing patient care and facilitating, ensuring safe patient care being happening on the unit. So through the integration of the technology, we have an e-nurse call system that is working directly with our patients, that they are able to, through the push of a button, being able to tell the nurses directly what they need without even using voice. This piece here, this is a smart badge. Every one of our clinicians that works on that unit carries a smart badge. The smart badge locates you in time. So it's a large unit, and when you need to find somebody, instead of paging overhead, you just look at a screen, and you're able to identify where that person is. The smart badge also allows that when you are entering a patient room, if a patient calls you and you need to enter the room, when you enter the room, we've created basically a smart room. So when you walk into the room recognizes who you are, and it reacts to your presence, as opposed to the other way around, where the nurses are having to touch all kinds of buttons. And it interacts with the bed as well. So the bed recognizes that you're in the room, and if it's alarming, it shuts it off, knowing that you will actually be dealing and caring for that patient care need. The other piece is electronic signage. So it will recognize you in the room, and it will indicate at the nurse's station, as well as outside the room, that you are there, and that there is a registered nurse in the room. The communication system is something that's really important. So if I've got a patient here and you've got a patient in the next two rooms, any patient that calls you, they're able to locate you right away where you are, and you're able to have a conversation with them either in the room, or the call is automatically transferred through your smart badge out into the hallway where you can have a private conversation. So these are technologies that staff are quite excited about having the opportunity to integrate that into their practice. And we're, like I said, we just turned on the switch on Monday. And it truly is an exciting time, both for clinicians as well as the organization. In looking specifically at innovation and patient safety, hand hygiene is a really important component within healthcare. So World Health Organization states that the number one thing you can do to minimize the risk of transmission of diseases is wash your hands, clean your hands. And in healthcare, we have a very labor-intensive, archaic way of monitoring how well we do our hand hygiene. We have somebody who stands there and watches you. And they watch you, and they keep watching you, and they do a little on a piece of paper, no less, and fill in boxes. And then those boxes are taken, and they're manually looked at by someone to calculate the percentage of hand hygiene. We need to evolve beyond that. And so the smart badge that nurses are wearing, physicians are wearing, physiotherapists are wearing, every healthcare team member is wearing, the administrators on that unit are wearing it. It will monitor your hand hygiene compliance in real time. so it will know whether or not you've cleaned your hands going into the room and whether or not you've cleaned it out. We believe that this particular technology that we have put into place will be a game changer for all of, we think that this will be the standard for Ontario hospitals going forward. The ROI on this, we are intending to see that we will have decreased transmission rates and less hospital-acquired infections. Safety, we have controls that automatically get fed into our electronic health record. So at the head of the bed of somebody who is requiring a G2 feed, that kind of stuff automatically gets, will be integrated right into the electronic documentation system. So we know that there are basic kinds of things that nurses and other care providers do not need to be documenting over again. It's already there. How do we take it from the smart bed and document it right into the patient's chart? The system knows exactly how many side rails are up, how many are down, how long the patient has been in bed, and how long that they've been out of bed. And that can automatically be, again, transmitted right into the electronic health record. You know how many things are on your to-do list, right? I'm sure it's going through your head right now and what you have to do when you get out of here. If for nursing, we have maybe 4 or 5 patients, we have to remember hundreds of things that have to happen every single day for each one of those patients. With this reminder, it tells you before you get into the room when the last time you were there, and when the last time you checked your IV, when the last time the patient needs to be churned, and when the last time the patient received their medications. These are reminders that support clinicians to do the best care possible for every patient, every time. These are our scorecards. So this is just one of the, where you have just letting you know patients how long they've been in bed and how long they have not been. An indication of where their risks are at. So you can get a bird's eye view of what's happening with your patient at any given time. These are our scorecards. So one of the things that we struggle with every day is knowing how well we're doing. Sometimes it's a lag time. We don't get this information until weeks, sometimes months later. This is real time. So as a manager of the unit, I can go up and I can pull up my screen and get the metrics of what's happening. If I see lots of red up there and I've been out of a meeting for an hour, a couple of hours off the unit, I can quickly know what's happening and intervene in a timely way. Again, this is an opportunity, another scorecard based on clinician, based on patient care. We know where we as managers, we want to be able to support our clinicians to do the right thing. Again, it's an opportunity to look at innovation from an evaluative perspective and say, how do we use data to drive quality improvement? How do we use data to intervene to do the right thing? And then how do we use it cumulatively to transform the healthcare system? So it's both at a local and more broad level. This is another visual. I'm not sure if you've ever lost your keys or trying to find how many times you called your cell phone, find out where it is. This is a visual. So we will have a map of each of the units and tell you exactly where any of the equipment is. This is not happening anywhere in Canada. We're the first hospital to do this, and it will inform our work going forward for the Mackenzie Vaughan Hospital. It will decrease work time, and it will increase patient. It will increase staff satisfaction and provide timely and effective care for our patients. We have a partnership model that we are looking at, as Altoff mentioned. We are working with our Ivy Business School, with our industry partner, and Mackenzie Health to look at how can we look at what we're doing so that we can inform and test. We think these are going to work, but we want a third party to work with us around how to make this better. So that in a nutshell is what we're doing, and I would welcome any questions that you may have.